So welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Let's start the press conference, informal ECOFIN press conference. Welcome in Vilnius, first of all. This is one of the main events of the Lithuanian presidency in the European Union, I think. We had a really busy day. A really busy day that started from the meeting of the Eurogroup. And I, as a president of ECOFIN, was invited for one of the questions of this meeting of the Eurogroup. This is the first time that this happens with a non-Eurozone presidency. And I think this is a good sign of all the countries striving not to have two-speed Europe. And the way towards better coordination of these two absolutely different bodies with different different jobs. ECOFIN is a legislative body, and Eurogroup is designed to manage the issues associated with the Eurozone. Of other issues that have been discussed, we had many items on our agenda, you know them. I would outline two that caused called for a substantial, very fruitful discussion. And the first is banking union, and especially a single resolution mechanism. We had an orientational debate so as to clarify what the initial positions of the member states are, so as to speed up the work of the presidency on this file, on this particular dossier, so as to finish with it during this political cycle, which is in our obligation according to the decision of our leaders. And the second discussion, also very fruitful discussion, concerned European Investment Bank and Commission initiative on instruments of small and medium enterprises financing. For the essence, I think, for essence of these discussions, of course, we don't take decisions here because this is an informal ECOFIN, but you can ask questions. Here you have Commissioners Michel Barnier, Olli Rehn, Johannes Hahn, who is present at the ECOFIN for the first time, I think, and Vitor Constancio from the European Central Bank. So now, up to your questions. Or perhaps presentations of the commissioners. Yeah, Michel or Olli.
Thank you, Rimantas. I will, to save time, I will just focus on one issue which we discussed this afternoon, and that is the very important issue of SME financing. I also reported on other issues, including the St. Petersburg summit of G20 last week, where Europe was for the first time for several years not the epicenter of the discussion or the crisis. And we saw last week in St. Petersburg that the world economy is no more moving with a three-speed trend, but rather we have a multi-speed recovery where growth is picking up in the advanced economies while slowing down in the emerging economies. And I also informed the ministers that the next meeting of the IMF in October will likely focus on the issue of spillovers of unconventional monetary policy, and we are preparing for that discussion, supporting the IMF in order to have a genuinely global strategy to address this important challenge. But on the issue of SME financing, there are as yet few signs that the stabilization of financial markets and the gradual upturn in the European economy are translating into improved lending conditions for small and medium-sized enterprises. Businesses, especially in Southern Europe, continue to face significantly higher rates than their competitors in Northern Europe. which is holding back the recovery of growth and jobs. Without affordable credit, we will not see the investment needed to support a sustainable recovery and job creation. Thus, there is a clear case for action by the European Union to address this market failure. The Commission has been working hard together with the European Investment Bank and the European Investment Fund to flesh out the SME initiative, which was originally supported by the European Council in June. The proposed SME financing initiative would bring critical added value in a number of ways. I just list these. First, it would help to overcome the fragmentation of financial markets in Europe and thus contribute to repairing the impaired credit channel. Second, despite being a new initiative, it could be implemented under the existing and tested framework of the community instruments like COSME and Horizon 2020. And third, it would help develop European capital markets by revitalizing the European market in asset-backed securities and thereby reducing the reliance on European SMEs on bank financing. And fourth, the involvement of the EIB and EIF in the structuring of each transaction would provide a standard approach and facilitate the investors' analysis of each transaction. The EIB group would make sure that risk is properly assessed and managed in all these transactions. And finally, the SME initiative would complement the national actions taken in support of SMEs using the structural funds. So, in order to proceed further with the necessary technical work for the implementation of this initiative, we need a very clear commitment of support from the Member States at the European Council in October. I have made the case strongly today for this political support in our meeting today, and I would like to make it again now also through the media. Quite simply, for the sake of the recovery and the SMEs that are the backbone of our economy and society, we have to make this happen. We've done all the necessary policy preparation and technical work. Now it's the moment of truth for the Member States and for the European institutions, where the Member States call the shots to take the necessary decisions and move forward and make this happen. Thank you.
Now, Commissioner Barnier.
Good evening to all of you. And first of all, I wish switch to French in a few seconds, but I just want to thanks Rimantas and his team for the perfect organization of this ECOFIN, informal ECOFIN meeting. This ECOFIN meeting takes place 24 hours after the large vote of the European Parliament supporting the first pillar of the banking union, the supervisory European mechanism. And this meeting takes place also day 5 years after the collapse of Lehman Brothers. On that point, there is nothing to celebrate, but a lot to remember and a call for action. And we have acted a lot for the last 4 years, 3 years and a half for me, even if I think that there is still a long way to go. Parlons d'action.
Now let's talk about actions. I won't run you through the list of the 20 pieces of legislation on regulation which we have proposed, some of which have been adopted and implemented already together with the Council and the Parliament over the last 3 years. The important thing for me is what's still ahead of us, what still has to be done at global and European level. At global level, G20 has just made the point again very firmly that everything that's been decided on needs to be done. That is decided on each of the G20 meetings which have followed Lehman Brothers and other crises. We need to make sure we have full implementation of all G20 decisions. That means not just us, but everybody at home. Everybody has to make sure that everything is implemented whilst remaining interoperable between the various sets of rules under our various legislation. We need to make sure all these rules are coherent with each other, which is why I spend so much time on interoperability, working together with our American partners, who are, after all, our most important partner study on financial markets, even if they're not the only ones. Then at European level, the priority now is to complete the banking union. Yesterday's vote in the Parliament was a decisive stage in that. Today, under the Lithuanian presidency at their initiative, we have had a first policy debate to start negotiations on my proposal made in July from the Commission on a European system for resolution. We had a working lunch over which we had a challenging debate, if I could put it that way. What else can I say to try and sum up on that first policy debate? Firstly, there's a consensus around the objective. Moreover, that objective was stated and restated by the European Council, that is, by the heads of government. Secondly, a broad agreement on the rules. Let me remind you that the banking union in the euro area consists of implementing in an integrated, more effective way the same rules as in the 28 member states, the same single rulebook, in particular on resolution, the resolution directive, which is being finalized in the Parliament and the Council, and also the text on deposit guarantees, because they're all linked. So we're looking at a single rulebook for the whole of a single market, and I do insist very much on the integrity of the single market. But in the euro area, because of our interdependence and these very strong links, two strong links indeed between banks and sovereign debt, we decided to establish the banking union to make sure these rules are implemented more effectively. Now, on the proposals themselves, they provide a legal framework. We are comforted by the opinion expressed by the Council Legal Service, the legal experts in the Central Bank and the Commission's own experts all tell us that the basis I chose, Article 114, is correct and workable. It seems the right legal base to us because it's a question of stability of the single market. Stability of the euro area means stability of the single market. So we'll continue to work on that basis, even if, echoing some concerns expressed in particular by the German minister, who I also listened to very carefully, as indeed all other ministers, Wolfgang Schäuble made the point that at a later stage, we ourselves in the Commission, in our blueprint, wish to see a change to the treaty to make sure that economic and monetary union can work better. With such a change, one can start to think in terms of making improvements and consolidating the resolution system. And we'll work on that in due course, but it's a matter of urgency. We need to get results soon. Then, regards the scope, there too, it seems to me that a large number of ministers share our concern we should work on all banks. Now, there are some small banks which can cause big problems. I also made the point that, as with supervision, I would be ready to improve the working arrangements of the system regards its scope. Now, regards the decision-making procedure, and this is where many comments, indeed reservations, have been expressed, for example, regards the role to be played by the Commission. Ladies and gentlemen, let me state quite clearly what I said already in presenting the text in July. There's no ideology on the part of the Commission regards our role to be played. We're not seeking an extra role on resolution. We've got enough roles as it is. The only thing is the system has to work, which is why we propose this resolution board, which in fact, as I see it, is something more and better than merely bringing together the national resolution authorities. That's not enough. The status quo can't work. We've seen the difficulties with Dexia and other cases by merely trying to do things by juxtaposition. Therefore, we propose a resolution board, which becomes the main body preparing for the decisions on resolution, which then will implement it alongside national authorities. We need a European institution that presses the button. And until something on those lines, something different, which would work as well, legally speaking, has been proposed, we stand by the role we have proposed for European Commission. But there's no ideology behind this. If somebody has a better idea, we'd be keen to look at it in an objective way. Regards the timing, my feeling listening to the European Parliament is they want something to be done urgently. Yesterday and the day before, Mrs. Elisa Ferreira, who's rapporteur on the text, said that she's ready to get the Parliament to express its views in November already as a matter of urgency and responsibility. And I heard from Minister Jenny the same feeling that this is urgent, echoing indeed what heads of government have felt. Even if it is difficult and legally complicated and sensitive, and I do understand all these issues, and none of them shock me or surprise me. But I think it's quite possible, notwithstanding the difficulty, to get results in the coming months, perhaps even by the end of the year. I believe we can get an agreement on the part of the two co-legislators, and we in the Commission are ready to work on a dynamic compromise on this issue, which represents the second pillar of a banking union. A banking union needs to function on the basis of these two pillars.
Johannes.
Thank you very briefly. First of all, thank you, Rimantas, for having invited me here to the informal ministerial conference to share with finance ministers the opportunities given by structural funds, but also the limitations. First of all, I think it's important to reiterate structural funds are the by far most relevant investment tool of the European Union. Provided the final adoption of the next multi-annual financial framework, we will get a budget of all in all 325 billion euro for the next 7 years. Already in the current period, we spent around 70 billion euro for the support of SMEs, which is around 20%, and we have discussed today what can be done in the next financial perspective to increase, not only in terms of absolute numbers, but also in terms of instruments, the opportunities to support European SMEs. We would like to double the amount to support SMEs from now 70 billion to 140 billion euros. Currently, we spend only 12 billion euros for financial instruments, and we would like to raise this figure, this amount, up to 30 to 40 billion euros in the next financial perspective, given that member states make use of the different instruments we have already in place. And today we have presented and discussed new opportunities together with the European Investment Bank, the European Fund. And I think the discussion was rather promising, and we can continue. I think it's important, finally, a naive calculation, but it gives you a feeling, it gives you an idea about the relevance of small and medium-sized companies. we have 23 million small and medium-sized companies in Europe, and we have 27 million unemployed people. So if more or less each SME would be able to employ one unemployed person, the problem of unemployment would nearly be resolved. If we leave this problem to the 500 biggest companies in Europe, each of them would have to employ 50,000 unemployed people, which is even theoretically unrealistic. So to support SMEs is of utmost importance, and it was shared by the finance ministers, and I'm confident that in the next financial perspective, a lot of member states, currently already 25, will make use of the different financial instruments, and in particular, also of the new ones we have presented today. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Minister. I'll make three brief points. One point of our agenda this afternoon was also the assessment of the economic outlook and also the situation of financial stability in Europe. And I just want to reiterate that we also share the view that there is a recovery that has started in the second quarter. But as President Draghi said 2 days ago, is still very fragile. Our own staff projections that were disclosed recently indicate that growth in the euro area this year will be negative, minus 0.4, and just 1% positive next year, and the risks are still to the downside. So no complacency is justifiable, especially in view of the situation of high unemployment that Commissioner Johannes just reminded us. So the second point I want to make is about the problem of credit to SMEs. We have also raised this issue some time ago. We have worked alongside the Commission and the European Investment Bank in preparing possible initiatives to deal with the question. And at the same time, we have in July reduced the level of ratings that we require to accept collateral that has relation to SME loans. We have also reduced in July the haircuts that we apply to that collateral in order to facilitate the initiative that may come out of the decisions that are expected about launching such a program for, in order for those instruments to be eligible as collateral for our monetary policy. We have also, last year, we have also enlarged our policy of eligible collateral by admitting as collateral small loans per se or in pool in our decision to create this segment of our collateral called ACC or additional credit claims. So loans, not securities, can be used directly as collateral in our monetary policy. And those small loans, of course, most of them are for SMEs. So we have been really, along with the Commission and the EIB, working to create better conditions for credit to SMEs to be possible. Finally, a word on what Commissioner Barnier said on the single resolution mechanism. We, of course, welcome the vote in Parliament of the SSM regulation, which is a very important first step. We are working a lot intensively to prepare things for to start next year supervising banks as SSM. And we also have stated many times that we see the need for a single resolution mechanism in Europe to complement the single supervisory mechanism. And in that respect, we have underlined three features of such a mechanism that are important in our view. The first one is that it must be a truly European decision-making body, meaning not subject to unanimity or national vetoes. So that's essential, because we want really a true European decision making, as it will be the case for the SSM. Second, the new entity must have at its disposal a fund to implement resolution policies. And this fund, of course, is made of contributions by the sector itself. But there is a third feature that it's important for such a fund, which is that bridge financing must be also available. When the fund has, in a particular moment, not enough resources, it can and should have then the possibility of getting bridge financing, which has to be repaid afterwards from the contributions coming from the banking sector. So it does not imply, in the end, public money. That is exactly the way this works in the US with the FDIC. So these three features are very important. And the proposal that was presented by the Commission respects these basic features of the single resolution mechanism. And of course, we welcome that this is so, and we support the initiative. We have not ourselves said anything about the institutional framework of this new entity. It's not the more important point for us. The important point for us is the features of the single resolution mechanism that I just highlighted. Thank you.
Thank you. Now time for questions. Please identify yourself and please state who you are addressing your question to. Jan.
Hello. Jan Stopczewski from Reuters. I have a question, two questions actually. Well, one is regarding financing for SMEs. In June, there was a joint initiative by the Commission and the EIB, which had three options that included leveraging. There were some numbers mentioned, 55 to 100 billion euros in new loans through the use of 10 billion euros from the EIB. I was wondering if the ministers had a chance to choose one of these options or a combination of those. And I want to ask, why is it that, again, the European Council has to approve this, because it already had done so in June and said it was it supported the initiative. So I wonder why does it have to again in October approve the same thing? And second question is regarding the banking union. There has been a controversy whether or not banking union can be based on the existing treaties or not. Germany was claiming that there has to be treaty change. Legal opinion from various institutions in the EU said that there was no need to change the treaty. I was wondering if there was a consensus emerging now that indeed the SRM can be based on the existing treaty, for example, on Article 352, I think, not 114, as was mentioned in the legal opinions, and that it can move forward without the lengthy and risky process of treaty change. Thank you.
So concerning these options in the EIB and Commission initiative, we had a discussion and we chose the most appropriate variant that will be further elaborated. In October, formal ECOFIN will approve my letter, signed by me, to Herman Van Rompuy, as requested by heads of state. Did I answer your question?
Thank you. Sur le second point, le conseil informel.
On the second point, this is an informal council, which means there aren't any formal decisions, just a general orientation debate. The ministers expressed some concern, some ministers, about the legal security, the legal base we chose. What can I say in reply? We have to aim for results. We've been asked to do this, to act quickly by the heads of state and government. There is always a risk of possible crises that we have to face up to. We can't waste time. Time is money. And indeed, you will have understood that our whole system is based, our whole approach is based on reducing the burden on taxpayers. They have paid far too much in the past to pay for the mistakes of the banks. So I have been working with my colleagues and with our legal service, which is extremely competent on the basis of Article 114 of the treaty, with a view to following a comparable approach, the European Central Bank as well. So I do believe it's possible. We're not shutting the door on later improvements to the system. We can go a little bit further, if the treaty were to be modified at a later stage, and this is something which the Commission itself called for in the blueprint, one could, for example, imagine a new status for the ESM, which could become a community institution, for example. If that were to be the case, one could imagine that the Commission's role and pressing on the button for resolution could be transferred, perhaps, to the ESM at some time in the future. But that is not possible for the time being. As has been said, we need an efficient community process. So I'm trying to be very pragmatic and non-ideological about it. I'm looking towards the best possible solution. But we do need to put in place a European system that actually works, a workable system. That is the whole purpose of what we've been doing with Article 114.
Hi, Jim Brunsden from Bloomberg News. My question's actually for Vice President Constancio. Vice President, you pointed out that the ECB is already working to get ready to take on its supervisory role from second half of next year. And the ECB's also always said that you have to have a single resolution mechanism to stand alongside the SSM. Why is that so important for the ECB, and how problematic, given that it looks like we're now in some very difficult discussions on the SRM, how problematic is it for the ECB if the SRM is not ready on time? Thank you very much.
Well, of course, as we have said, it's important to have this instrument. Why? Because when we supervise banks, institutions, it may occur that an institution has no other solution but to be resolved. And the problem then arises mostly in what regards possible events regarding a cross-border institution that has activity in various countries. And we have seen during the crisis and even before that when those cases emerge, and they have emerged, in fact, during that period, it is very difficult to do that task. And the supervisor has to be confident and has to have the assurance that when the conclusion is that the institution has to be resolved, there are ways of doing it in an orderly but efficient and as quick fashion as possible. So that's why it is important. Of course, as we are not anticipating problems of banks of this type in the near future after the crisis we have had, if it is not ready in the very first day, then of course it will not in itself be a problem, but it should exist as soon as it is possible, and that's what we have insisted upon. And by the way, another point here also, which is important, has to do with the fact that the resolution authority will have to work in the context of the directive of bank resolution, And as you know, important sections of that directive, as they have been approved by the Council, still to be now discussed with Parliament and so on, only will enter into force after, say, next year. So that's another thing that makes it true that if it is not available in the very first day, that is not, of course, a major problem, but still it must be there as soon as possible. Thank you.
Hello, just over here. Martina Seves from the Wall Street Journal. A question for Mr. Constanzo, if possible. Following up from Jim's question on the timing of the resolution mechanism, there is a possibility that the very robust asset quality review and stress test that you've been talking about will turn out to show that there are banks somewhere that need to be either resolved or recapitalized. You and your colleagues have spoken about how to go about perhaps recapitalizing them and how to deal with them. Would it not be better if there was an SRM and a fund associated with that to deal with potential banks that need to be resolved at the back of the stress tests that will happen before the SSM actually begins?
Yes, it will be good if it would be available, no doubt. I don't deny that, but it's still workable. If that happens, and by the way, we are not anticipating at all that significant banks, meaning international cross-border banks, will face such a situation as a result of the balance sheet assessment. Because banks, in fact, if you look to the figures, European banks in particular, those that have international activity and are cross-border, have improved their capital positions. Their stock prices have increased recently more than non-financial firms, which means that there is recognition by the market that the robustness of those banks has improved, both in terms of capital, also in terms of provisions. You have seen noted, and it has been reported in the media, that in various countries, the national supervisory authorities, in anticipation of the balance sheet assessments, are putting pressure on the banks to increase their provisions and to increase their capital buffers. And this is happening. It's already a result of the existence of the balance sheet assessment that is coming. So one has to take that all that into consideration when we will then analyze the final results of the balance sheet assessment. It will be rigorous. It will be credible. Because that's very important for the health of the banking sector in Europe, and we have to deliver that, even taking into consideration what is already happening in association with that initiative. But you can be sure, and it has been already also announced, that third parties will be involved in the exercise, which will enhance the credibility of the exercise. It's not only an internal thing done by the Eurosystem itself. It will involve firms and consultants, as it has been the case in Spain, in Greece, in Ireland, in Portugal, because we have the experience of these balance sheet assessments and asset quality reviews in all these countries that have received assistance from European funds. So that is also going to happen, and we are confident that we can reassure markets that the result of our balance sheet assessment will be credible in order to improve the situation of the European banking sector. But if a resolution mechanism would be in place, yes. But that's my last point. Of course, resolution happens and can happen because there are national resolution authorities. Several countries, since the crisis, have passed new resolution laws, which are quite compatible with the directive that now is being finalized. And so these mechanisms are available at national level. If the need would arise.
Last question.
Jorge Valero with Europolitics. It's coming back to the SMEs question. Today, the Council proposed or prioritized one again tackling the problems of financing of the SMEs. But when it comes to real allocation of money, like in the budget proposal for 2014, the Council has lowered the Commission's proposal, especially for some of the allocations that will go to the SMEs. So would you describe Council's position as coherent? And do you think that maybe both positions, what is agreed today and what is agreed or ongoing in the 2014 negotiations, will match? Thank you.
I mean, if first of all, we have to say the Council decision about the multi-annual financial framework, which has to be confirmed or adopted finally also by the Parliament, is an expression of the general budgetary situation. And each policy area had to face certain cuts, and the structural funds were the lowest, faced the lowest cuts, only all in all 4%. So our challenge now was and is to make best use of the now available amount of money. And in that respect, we have thought, and this was one of the reasons for my intervention, saying that we would like to increase the amount of money being used for financial instruments. And in that respect, I believe we can not only compensate, but even more, the losses in absolute amount related to the budget. So it's up to us, up to the member state, to make best use of the available amount of money and to have a lot of creativity and to use all the opportunities related to financial instruments by structural funds, but also by other financial means.
I can simply add that this initiative is about mobilizing additional resources. If EIB provides guarantees as foreseen in one of the options, this could help SMEs to raise money in the market, additionally to raise money in the market. Structural funds, of course, can be used and will be used in different countries for this purpose, for additional financing. But what we agreed today is that all the decisions in the member states will be voluntary. The choice of options will be quite consistent with the policies of the member state and the needs of the member state in question. And we favor combination of options if it is appropriate, so that to make the mechanism to work at these quite difficult, I agree with you, quite difficult budgetary, European budgetary conditions, as well as possible.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Commissioners. Thank you, Central Bank representative. Thank you.